This is a demonstration of measuring the axle hub runout on a vehicle. This round hub right here is what centers the wheels, at least the factory wheels, on most vehicles. And if it is kind of wobbling up and down as it's rotating as you drive down the road, then that can lead to a first order tire speed related vibration. And a first order vibration is anything that creates one shake or one disturbance per revolution of whatever that part is. So a first order tire speed related vibration, it would create one shake per revolution. So we are going to hook up a dial indicator to measure this hub for roundness. But the problem we have here is there are studs in the way. So we can't just simply come in with a dial indicator on this surface right here, because as we rotate the axle shaft around, the studs would hit it. So instead, we have to use an adapter here with another dial indicator. And this adapter I refer to as a teeter-totter adapter. I guess I've never actually looked up its official name. I think it's actually called an inside hole adapter for a dial indicator. But you slide the dial indicator into this adapter and align the plunger of the dial indicator up with this little teeter-totter looking piece. And we have a 1-to-1 ratio of the teeter-totter. So however far I push down over here on the right, the plunger will be pushed up on the left by the same amount. So if I push down with 10 thousandths of an inch, the other side will go up 10 thousandths of an inch. And then we can read in thousandths of an inch on the face of this dial indicator. And what we're going to do is hook this up to a dial indicator stand to where we can read inside, and this is long enough that it's going to miss the wheel studs, but we're going to come in underneath with this little adapter and it'll push up. So I'm going to have it mounted just like this, and I'll have to reposition the camera so you can see the setup and the dial indicator measurement. But this is the only way I've been able to figure out how to get in and measure how round this particular hub is. So let me get the dial indicator and the camera set up and repositioned, and we will go from there. Okay, I've got the dial indicator set up with the inside hole adapter, the part I called the teeter-totter adapter, reaching in and measuring the in or the outside diameter of this hub. We're not measuring the diameter, but we're on the outside circumference of this hub. And I'm going to zero the dial indicator at this point. That doesn't mean that's the high spot or the low spot. That's just a point where I'm going to start. Oh, come on. A comparison, and we're going to watch to see how high it goes above zero and how far it goes below zero, and that's our total indicated reading that we're looking for here. So here we go. Oh, whoops, I was going the wrong way. All right, let's try that again. The little teeter-totter adapter has some lateral movement, so you've got to always rotate in the same direction. So let me hit let me zero that again. Here we go. Okay, so here we go. We're on zero. About a one, maybe two, and back to zero. So we had about 2/1000ths of an inch run out. There's still a little bit of surface rust that I was unable to clean up with the sandpaper. But 2/1000ths of an inch, three is the maximum allowed. So The ones I've seen, like I said, that are in really good shape have no run out. It's just dead zero or just a tiny bit above, but less than 1/1000th of an inch. This one has two, but that includes the some of the surface rust. It's still less than the 3 specification, so we're in good shape. Now, if it had more than the 3/1000th of an inch, then you'd have to replace the axle shaft itself, because that would cause the wheel entire assembly to be moving up and down as you drive down the road. So this is one of two measurements that you do on an axle shaft for runout. The other measurement is going to be on this outer flange for runout, for the lateral runout, side to side. So this is vertical runout on this hub, the up and down runout. Now we're going to measure lateral, which is out here, for side to side runout. So let me get the dial indicator set up for that, and we'll measure that next. Okay, I've now got the dial indicator hooked up with the roller tip, and we're going to measure the runout of this axle flange surface here. If it has run out, then it'll cause the wheel entire assembly to wobble back and forth. That's lateral run out, which can also cause a first order tire speed related vibration. So let me zoom in here just a little bit. We can watch the dial indicator. So let's get that zeroed. Once again, we're just looking for total indicated reading of runout. So how high does it go above zero? How far does it go below zero? And let's see what we have. This should also not exceed 3/1000th of an inch. Looks like we got up close to 3, but did not exceed the 3/1000th. If it did exceed 3/1000th, you may have a bent axle shaft. Maybe the car or truck was in an accident, or they've hit a really big pothole or a rock or a curb or something with their tire and wheel assembly. That can bend this axle face here. Or the axle shaft itself. So, okay, there is one more measurement on the this axle flange area that we need to consider, and that is that it's the brake rotor that slides over these wheel studs and sits on this surface. And so the surface rust on the back of the brake rotor can cause the brake rotor to have excessive run out in the same area, and that could cause the wheel to have excessive run out also. I've also seen where the flange area of the rotor that slides over these wheel studs is not equal thickness all the way around. And so if you do this same check with the dial indicator after putting the brake rotor on, you're going to get a different reading. Now, we measured close to 3/1000th of an inch runout on this axle shaft. Let's take this same measurement but with the brake rotor installed and see if there's any difference. If there is, then it could be surface rust contributing or unequal thickness of the flange where it slides over the studs. All right, we're looking at the back of the brake rotor, and you can see there's surface rust there, but it's in a pattern that matched how it was removed from the vehicle. And you'll notice that on the wheel studs here, that I put a paint mark on this wheel stud, and there's a paint mark here on the brake rotor where that wheel stud went through. And so we're looking to have those two matched up when you put that on. That way your rust pattern on the back will match how it was when you took it off. Now, I know not everybody cleans up that surface rust every single time that they take a brake rotor on or off and put it back on. And you can minimize the amount of lateral runout caused by not cleaning that up by making these marks before you disassemble it. So let me get the dial indicator set up. We're going to measure the runout on this surface now where the wheel rides, but through the brake rotor itself. And of course I'll put some wheel studs on or lug nuts on here to hold it down. Okay, I've now got the dial indicator with the roller contact out here on the outside of the brake rotor hub area. I can't come in any closer because of this hole here in the brake rotor, and so I'm going to have to measure it out here, but we're going to still hold to the 3/1000ths of an inch maximum runout. But realize the farther away you get from the center of the axle, the more runout you're going to have. 3/1000ths out here would be less than 3/1000ths in here. It's like a piece of pizza. It's wide out here and pointed. It's much smaller on the inside there. So let's rotate this around and see how much runout we have with the brake rotor on. Now remember, we had a little less than 3/1000ths run out without the brake rotor. And so here we go. We're on zero there. Let's see what we get. Whoa. That is a lot of run out. wow, that's a lot more than I thought. Let's look at that again. Okay, so we're at zero. Went about three under zero. We go all the way around past zero, that's 50/1000ths. 55, 60, about 63/1000ths of an inch, plus the two that went below the zero to give us right there, 65/1000ths of an inch lateral runout, the wobble back and forth. Now, why would it be that much? Well, I'm measuring out here on this outer edge rather than in here a little closer where the I'm an inch away from where the wheel rides on the brake rotor. I'm an inch farther out, but this rotor could be damaged. This is a training vehicle, and so who knows who's been pounding on it with a hammer to get it off rather than putting the screws in or the bolts in to pull it off or to push it off with the a threaded bolt pushing against the axle flange. Maybe somebody's hit it with a hammer and bent it, but this would, since it has 65/1000ths of an inch lateral runout here, imagine how much more that's going to be out here at the edge of the tire. So it'll be interesting to put the tire and wheel assembly on here next and see how much lateral runout we have in the tire and wheel assembly. So this has been a demonstration of measuring runout on axles, and we've measured the hub runout, the axle flange run out under the brake rotor, and now the flange run out on top of the rotor, and we've seen that it's way out of specification on this one. By the way, another reason it could be that much is mismachining of this rotor. I've seen, once again, where the thickness of this rotor is not equal all the way around. But let's also not forget surface rust. There could be surface rust on the other side that's contributing to that. So it would be interesting to clean all of that up and see how much it reduced the runout. But if you just slap it all together like this, you're going to expect to have some lateral runout as you drive down the road. And vehicles are less susceptible to lateral runout, the side to side, than they are to radial runout, which is the up and down runout.